raise my eyebrows up and down quickly in order to show you that there's going to be a surprise. Are you ready?
Yes.
Did that look surprising?
Very surprising.
Okay, good, I'm glad. Don't worry, everyone, I shall take my dark glasses off when the real show starts. This isn't the show, you know. It's the pre-show show. It's deeply confusing. Oh, I have to tell you something. You have to push, you have to click subscribe. Apparently, there's a little, what is it? The bell, a little bell. There's a little bell, and what the bell will do is go bing every time we go live. And then you will know when we're live, because I think maybe you don't know when we're live, or do you? Well, you wouldn't really be with us if you didn't. That's all very confusing, everyone. Don't worry, there are only two more minutes of confusion, then we'll hit the normal show and everyone will be able to heave a sigh of relief and we'll be okay. David, there's some zebra there, but because it's the pre-show show, we're not allowed to show them in great detail. We just drive past them. And I believe it's 29 degrees Celsius, 85 degrees Fahrenheit. It's a perfect temperature. In fact, it might even be described, David, as a delicious temperature. There are some minkies. Maybe we should stop for the minkies. Perhaps we should begin our drive with the minkies. And I'm going to take a picture of them, David. Can you believe how naughty I'm being? Whoop, whoop. Cuckoo. Look here, Minky. 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 This camera is so slow. Oh, I can hear baboon's alarm calling. That's good news. Let me tell Aubrey. Orbs, the baboon's alarm calling sounds like Mumba Road.
Confirm Mumba Road.
Yeah, I think Mumba Road Junction, Drakensberg.
This program features live coverage of an African safari and may include animal kills and carcasses. Viewer discretion is advised.
Good afternoon, everybody. Welcome to the northeast corner of South Africa. It's a gorgeous day, 29 degrees Celsius, 85 degrees Fahrenheit, and this is Safari Live.
Ready.
We have a very exciting show for you planned today. Of course, our best laid plans in the wilderness more often than not change completely as we go along, and that's the great joy of being out here. Up there, three vervet monkeys are sitting watching us almost as fascinatedly as we're watching them. My name is James Hendry. On camera today is David Eastor. Yes?
That's right.
That is really his name, Eastor. On the other vehicle, a surprise. Brian's on the other vehicle, and he said, when I tell you there's a surprise, I have to do this with my eyebrows. But eventually my face starts to do that. Anyway, there's a surprise on the other vehicle. I shan't tell you what it is, because then it wouldn't be a surprise, would it? No. Now, it's 29 degrees Celsius, as I said, 85 degrees Fahrenheit. Our plan is to go down the Mlwamati drainage line here and see if we can pick up Karula. She was not too far from here this morning, but she moved off from the kill that she had. They finished the dikesh, she and her two hungry little cubs. And I just heard baboon's alarm calling somewhere on Drakensberg Road and the junction with Mumba Road, which is, of course, meaningless to most of you. But it basically just means it's about I'd say 2 miles up towards the east. Aubrey's checking that way. We're going to check the drainage line and we'll see what we've come up with. It's such a gorgeous day that really, if we see nothing at all other than the magnificent atmosphere, smelling the flowers of summer, I shall be thoroughly satisfied regardless. Are you ready, David?
Yes.
Here we go. There are dung beetles buzzing about. There are birds, many vultures in the sky. There are cicadas calling. And it's just not hot enough to be unpleasant. It's wonderful. Now I'm just going to I need to keep the radio up relatively high today, I'm afraid, because of the surprise. Right, let us head down into the drainage. There is a zebra, which we shall look at, and this zebra is quite interesting. David, if you can get onto its bottom, which is difficult to miss given its fairly immense size. That zebra has not been unharmed in her life. You see that? She's very pregnant, and she's also escaped from lions on, I think, probably more than one occasion. The other side's also got a raking cut. Could be from the same lion that was kicked off her. See that? See where the skin is not quite healed. The stripes are just misaligned. Well done, old girl. She's not a young zebra, that. I can just tell that from the condition of her skin. But she's about to give birth again. She's very fat, full of a little foal. It will hopefully be as adept at escaping predators as its mother. She is grazing, of course. Loving the new grass. Studiously avoiding things that are not grass, and that's important to note. Well, if you're interested in what herbivores eat, I suppose. Otherwise, in the grand scheme of the world, it's probably not that important, is it, David?
No.
Kirsten, I'm afraid we're having the same trouble. Do you want to test again your comms? So Kirsten is in the final controlled. Right, here we go, everybody. Let me just set this up correctly. It's time for your surprise. His name is Christopher. He's on trial. Be nice to him, or you shall have to answer to me. He's a young man with a lot to tell you, and hopefully he and Brian are with the lions. Okay, right, so we don't have any communications with the surprise. Maybe you got a look at him. I'm not sure if you did. Communications this side aren't very good. I've turned my phone on, Kirsten. If you need to get hold of me, you can WhatsApp me. Otherwise, we'll see what happens as we go. Might be 3 hours solo. Let me put those back. Of course, I'm not allowed to wear these when we're live, everybody, because that would be wooed. I need to look you in the eye. Right, come on, David, don't be silly. Let's go and find a leopard. So we'll just sort those out. We'll sort the communications out with young Christopher. And please be aware, I know many of you are in a deep state of panic that Brent and Jamie are about to abscond and leave us because they've started that little safari guiding website. They are not about to leave us. Please fear not. Christopher is not here as a replacement for anybody. So let me sing it now from the depths of this drainage line. And when I get to the highest point of this property, I shall do the same again. Brent and Jamie will be back with us on Wednesday next week. There we are. Good. Okay, and we are going to try again to link to the surprise. Say hello to Christopher.
Good afternoon, everybody, and welcome here to this live safari where we are actually going out and filming this magnificent wildlife. For those of you that's been following us or following these guys, you will have noticed that I am the new guy on the block. This is in fact my first time being out here and doing something like this, having a massive camera staring me straight in the face and trying to teach you guys about what's going on out here and also just seeing this magnificent wildlife. Today with me, I've got Brian over here, and of course, Mr. Thun himself, which he's always got some funny little character on there. And I believe it's a fork today, so I don't know what he's planning on eating, but I'm sure we'll find out later in the show. Now, I don't know if this is beginner's luck, but we've surrounded completely here by a pride of lions. A couple of youngsters here, just to the left of us, three of them over there, and then a couple of females further to the front. Now, I've been trying to count them as I was waiting to go live here, and there must be at least 10 plus of them. So this is a typical nice pride with a couple of females and a couple of youngsters. And hearing from the other rangers around here, there must be about 8 youngsters over here, ranging from about 2 months to 6 months, which is absolutely phenomenal to see. Everyone's looking nice and healthy and just kind of relaxing in this super blazing day that we're having. The kind ladies in finals have told me that we're sitting at 29 degrees Celsius today, which makes it 85 degrees Fahrenheit. But I'll tell you what, it feels like it's a whole lot hotter once the sun is hitting you straight in the face. Hopefully with this hot heat going, we're going to have some massive cumulonimbus clouds building and get some more rain coming towards this side. It is unbelievably green here. I'm actually a local from this area. I don't want to give too much information away of myself. I'm sure you guys have loads of questions for the new face on the camera. So please feel free to ask us questions on Twitter at hashtag hashtag Brian, what's that? Safari Live. Sorry guys, it is my first time. I may have a bit of hiccups as we go along. And if you see me sweating, it is because I'm a little bit nervous, but also because it is 29 degrees Celsius. So I do apologize. But yeah, like I said, hopefully we're going to have some rain building up, which the animals will obviously greatly appreciate as we go along. Now you can... Well, thank you to all the viewers that say you're very excited to meet me. I'm very excited to be here. Like I said, it is my first time being on television or being on a live safari, facing a camera. But I am very, very excited. I don't know if they were trying to make me nervous or the directors, but they do say this is technically the biggest game drive I will be doing in my life, sometimes reaching over 2 million viewers, which is quite awesome to have. So as you can see, these lions at this moment are just trying to catch some shade. It's about, 5 minutes past four at the moment. The heat will slowly decline as we go on, and they'll probably get up. I do know they were eating on a buffalo, actually, which I'm sure we'll find for you guys a bit later on. Quite amazing how these guys are just dropping buffaloes left, right and center. And of course that has got to do with the severe drought we've been going through. Animals are very weak at the moment, making it very easy for your predators to take them down. I've been actually quite lucky. I arrived here 2 days ago. I've been lucky enough to go out on one drive this morning and just see what these animals are up to. I do believe you guys were with James just now. We are accompanied by James and Dave with the camera, and I believe they're going out to look for Karula, the female leopard, which I'm sure you guys know a lot more about than me, seeing it as my first time. As youngsters just looking around, there is another vehicle that's just pitched up here. Obviously a very, very nice sighting, so everyone wants a piece of the pie. Ooh, nice little yawn there. They do seem to be itching quite a bit, and I'm sure the other guards have spoken to you guys about this before. They do unfortunately have a bit of mange, but actually looking in rather good condition, not too bad. So it does seem like they're on the path of recovery, but obviously still a little itch here and there. Mm-hmm. Well, good afternoon, Valeria. Very good question. Of course, growing up in the bushveld here, you can come across a favorite animal, though it is very tough to see. You know, growing up with these animals and seeing them from a day-to-day basis, you do kind of fall in love with all of them. But if I have that question and I have to answer it, which I do, there's a big camera staring me in the face, I would say the African elephant. They are magnificent animals, and I can tell you a short, I'm not going to make it too long, little story about them and the reason to why they are my favorite animal. And it basically goes back to about when I was the age of 9, growing up in a reserve not too far from here as the crow flies, maybe about, can't be anything further than 50 kilometers. And what happened to this reserve is called Baluli Nature Reserve. We opened up to the Kruger National Park to form what we now call the Greater Kruger. And obviously, as the as we dropped the fences, the elephants came through. It was like candy land, fresh leaves, fresh marula trees, and they just came through. Now, with all these new elephants coming in and not being familiar with the area, they kind of got a bit agitated with the amount of vehicles driving around, and we basically got charged on a daily basis, which you can imagine, a 6-ton animal running straight at you, you're going to be shaking a little bit. So obviously, still at that young age, I was deathly terrified from them. I'd see them from 200 meters and I'd literally start crying, weeping myself, crying for mommy and grandpa to say, please just get me out of here. So obviously, my grandpa, being he was, he told me, Chris, you're growing up in the bush here, you are almost like the real life Tarzan. You cannot sit here and be afraid of elephants. So straight off to school every day, he would take me out and would go on foot and approach these elephants and just kind of study their behavior. And as time went by, when I was about the age of 15, I really had a huge amount of respect for them and worked out that they really are magnificent and honest animals with their behavior. Awesome to approach on foot. If you can just read their signs, it's the exact same as a human. You can see when a human is getting a bit angry, getting a bit agitated. It's the exact same with the animals out here. There's certain signs we can look for, and then you can avoid getting yourself into a dangerous situation. And also just the understanding, you know, that these elephants just came into a new area, so obviously they're going to be a bit edgy. So nothing on them, it was all on me. And I personally believe animals can feel that energy. So if you're being very frightened and scared, the same thing, they're going to react the same way. Okay, but enough about me and my stories. What a wonderful sighting we're having. Not too much activity at the moment. As we got here, there was 4 youngsters lying on the side, and the one's now moved across. And just look at that beautiful little face. Who could not love that, eh? Just resting in the shade of that marula tree. You can see still panting quite a bit. They obviously do have full bellies. Alrighty, so I got a question from that tuba guy. I'm not sure if I can pronounce it right. The comms aren't very great at the moment. But you're basically asking me how many cubs can I count. I'm not in the best position at the moment. But like Brian is just focusing on that one. We have that one lying under the marula tree to the left of the shot. You can see there, he's zooming in now. We got the other 2 youngsters lying there. So that's 3. And then straight in front of us there, he's zooming in. Well, there, first of all, we got a nice belly. Someone is busy catching a suntan there, but there is a couple more behind there, so I cannot give you an accurate count now, but I'll tell you what we will do, is we will reposition ourselves to try and get a bit of a view of those other youngsters just now. But I believe there is 8 in total, and please correct me if I am wrong. You guys obviously know more than me about this area that we're in at the moment. But as we got here, I had visual on 5 cubs, but I am sure there is more, just listening to what the other guides have been saying. So please let me know how many there are. I'm sure the directors will tell me as well, and so we can help each other get to this first drive of mine, which I'm now starting to calm down a bit. Alrighty, that's a confirmation. There is 8 of them. I can only see 3. There is another one popping his head up in front now. There we go. Alrighty guys, so that's me for now. What we're going to do is we're going to go back to James. We're going to see how he's doing with those leopards. Hopefully he's found her. So enjoy what's going on that side. See you now.
Right, back again, and that was Christopher, everybody, so I can stop making stupid motions with my face. Now, we're trying to find Karula. We've heard that one of the cubs was at the... remember where in that culvert where they were, when they were just born? Apparently, one of them was seen there, scuttling underneath. Where the other two are, I'm not sure. But I'm thinking about going towards... I'm thinking about going towards where the kill was and just having a quick squiz there. Because I thought there was perhaps enough meat there left for them to be. All right. I'm just going to quickly have to tell Kirsty. Chris is going to probably have to leave that sighting when in the next 10 minutes or so. I'm just telling Kirsten through you, you see, because there are other vehicles going there. But I think at the moment it's fine. Now, there's Aubrey's vehicle there, and it's in that culvert that the little youngster was. So we're just going to drive very slowly along here. There's a vulture in that tree there, Davey. Let's have a quick look at that, just while I assess what's going on here. There we go. This is a rather main road, you see. And this is where they were born, right where Aubrey's car is, which is in front of us. That is a white-backed vulture, in case you're wondering. And this is a main road, and that's why there are cars coming up and down it. It goes to Cheetah Plains and Chitwa Chitwa and Nkoro. That was me being polite. Did you see that, everyone? I waved at him. Now, let's just concentrate carefully here. I just want to ask Aubrey what's going on. Obringen. Minjani? Ahe. Kunaman pimpan in sana. Uchegile lenyamin. Okay, entirely. Ntache, gantiv. Uchegeta in. Okay. Alright, we're just going to go and check the kill site, everybody. I think we can probably just get a view, maybe, of a youngster here. But I believe the youngster has gone down into the culvert underneath the road. That means that Karula could easily be around here. The little spotted pelage knocking about underneath the shade. And interestingly, this morning we found the male on his own, and he had moved away from the others. And I wonder if that's not him exploring, maybe getting a bit of a fright because of all the activity of the cars going up and down. Anyway, we'll have a look now. I'll just quickly go to where the kill was. See what we can see, because that's where Shongile and Karula were earlier today. It's just in here. I can still smell the stomach contents. I don't know if you watched us this morning, everyone, but it was a fantastic, fantastic experience watching little Hosana, who is the male. If you're a new viewer, Hosana is a male. He's 9 months old, and his sister Shongile is also 9 months old. And he brought us, almost as a gift, he went down into the drainage line and he picked up the stomach contents of the duiker that they killed, or that his mother had killed, and he brought it towards us. And it was deeply, deeply disgusting. I don't know, it could be anywhere around here. So we're going to be very, very careful. But I suspect more strongly that they are actually closer by to where the one that's gone into the culvert is. Anyway, let's have a quick look. and then we'll press on and see what else we can see on this absolutely gorgeous afternoon. Now, it was on that termite mound there that we saw them this morning. The kill was down in this drainage. There wasn't a huge amount left. And when we did leave them, the two cubs were stalking a zebra, just playfully. And Mum was down in the shade. Let's go and see. We'll just stick our heads over the edge here. Don't see anything, David? I don't see anything either. Well, we're just going to go down here, and if we don't see anything, we'll hand you back to the lions. Nothing. Niggies. Okay, everyone, we're going to hand you back to Chris and the lions. We're going to look around here for a little bit longer and see what we can find. Otherwise, we'll press on. See you shortly.
Welcome back here with us on this lovely lion sighting we can have. You can see those two little youngsters, just a bit of interaction going on. And whilst you guys have been away, the female, the one lion nest, and I predicted some mother, you could see she was lactating, has actually led us to the kill. So I will shortly pull out of here and take us there and see what is happening. The rest of them still taking it very easy, trying to conserve as much energy as possible during the heat of the day. And obviously, being nocturnally active creatures, will get a little bit active as the day goes on. That guy's feeling like me, 3 in this morning, when I had to wake up, get ready to go out and drive. Still very, very sleepy. Couple of flies bothering there on the nose, probably from all the eating they've been doing. Bit of a smell there, so those flies are still just kind of having a bit of a feast all over his nose there. Look like he's in a nice deep dream there, maybe chasing a buffalo. A little bit ambitious, looking at his size. Look at that foot there just twitching along. Very cute. So we got a question from Margaret, and it's a very, very good question. In fact, she is asking if lions only eat when they are hungry. And I'll tell you the answer to that is they are opportunistic animals, and therefore they will actually go, and when there's an opportunity that's presented, they'll go and try and actually take it. And that's why you'll find, even like this, these lions have been killing buffalo after buffalo. This is what I'm hearing from the rangers, and not actually actually eating all the buffalo. Some of them have been left completely open and not even been fed on at all. Of course, that helps some of your other predators like your hyenas and your jackals. But yeah, basically the answer to that is no, they don't only hunt and eat when they are hungry. They will also do so even when they're on a full belly. I've, with my experience of being a game ranger, seen lions with absolute full bellies go and try and take down another animal, going straight from sleeping to trying to do that. So no, definitely not only when they are hungry. They are opportunistic creatures, and I think the way that they think is more that they never know when they're actually going to get a next meal. Obviously, the odds are extremely good at the moment. Animals are very weak. There's not a lot of food for most of the other animals. But yeah, they'll go out and grab any opportunity that's out there to take down something. And then most of the time, maybe even if they're full belly, have a little bit of a bite and then go lie down not too far away from the kill. And that's exactly what's happened here. Kind of keep an eye on it, make sure nothing else like your hyenas and jackals is going to come and try and steal a piece, which is quite stingy, to be honest, seeing as they've got full bellies and there's a 900 kilogram buffalo lying there. But that is just obviously the way of nature out here. Everyone is out here for himself and trying to survive. So guys, not too much movement going on here. I'm shortly gonna get us out of here, head over to the actual kill site and go and see what's going on there. As Absolutely awesome sighting. I tell you what, to be this close to lions, you can't always see with the camera exactly how close you are, obviously, because we're zooming in and zooming out. But what, Brian, we can't be further than 8 meters, 10 meters here, and they've got absolutely no problem with us being here, which is absolutely amazing. One of the perks of being in a pristine nature reserve like this, the Sabi Sands, which is, of course, open to the Kruger National Park. Absolutely phenomenal. These animals do obviously see vehicles, and as long as we are ethical with our guiding, they keep calm. It's kind of a respect for respect show that's going on. On our left here, we have the one lioness actually coming back. She just went to go check out if the killer's still nice and fresh, had a little bite or two, and is now probably just going to plonk down right there and take another little rest. Ooh, flies are bothering her. Licking those lips, yummy. Hi Sandy, your question is how long I've been guiding. I've been guiding now for a total of about 3.5 years in various different areas. I've quite lately become a freelance guide, and that's how I actually got to the position where I am right now in front of the camera. It's just trying to take as many opportunities as possible. And one of the perks of that is you do get to go to different reserves, such as one where I am in right now, the Sabi Sands, and it's just absolutely phenomenal. So yeah, about 3.5 years in total, most of that spending 2 years in the Kruger at a lodge down there in the south in the private concession, and then in between doing various other kind of excursions, so to call them, overlands, just traveling up Africa, trying to go see the gorillas up in Uganda, and then coming back, and from there just freelancing in some other of the nature reserves, especially around there where I'm living in Bululi. There's quite a couple of lodges. There we go. Sandy from Canada, thank you for that question. Thank you to everybody that is asking questions. It is definitely helping with my first time being out here, starting to get a bit more comfortable now and just being able to enjoy this sighting. Now you see, this is typical behavior for what the lions do as the day goes on and the temperature is dropping. They start kind of grooming each other, licking, trying to keep the fur and the hair nice and clean, especially after feeding. That hair is actually very important for them to kind of control their body temperature. And I'll tell you how it works. I'm going to ask Brian to just quickly focus on my hands here, and I'll give you a bit of a demonstration. So basically, and this is for most of our animals out here, how it works is, so the hair is just normally down. Now obviously after feeding, the bloody situation, it can get quite sticky. So they clean it, and the reason for doing that is because they want the hair to basically be able to erect and go down. And I'll tell you why that is. Let's say it's bright and early in the morning, it's a little bit chilly, 9-10 degrees Celsius, and obviously what they want is a bit of sun. The sun is just busy rising, so they kind of let the hairs up. It's called phyloerection, and now the sun is directly hitting the skin, and they do believe it actually forms like a bit of a coat. So it's like me and you putting on a jersey, and it kind of keeps the temperature in there. So now obviously if it's bloody and sticky, the hair is not going to be able to do this. So very typical behavior as they wake up is for them to start grooming each other and cleaning themselves up. There we go, some motherly love there. Isn't mom's just the best? Always out there to give you a lick when you need it. Now what we'll probably see as we wait here, the one vehicle seems to be moving out. So I'm going to spend a bit more time here with them. They are getting a bit more active. And what we'll probably start seeing, and I'm sure you guys have seen it in the previous shows, these youngsters are extremely playful, which is obviously very important for their growing up, starting to develop those cohorts for hunting and stalking and fighting for as they get older. So we'll just keep a tight eye on them and see what they get up to. What I'm actually going to do is I'm just going to position us a little bit more forward so we can have a look at the other lioness more to the right there. So I've got another question coming through here from James, which is also a very, very good question. Ooh, sorry, little youngster, you got a bit of a fright there. Do I prefer taking guests on bushwalks or game drives? Now, personally, I'm going to say I do actually lately do enjoy bushwalks quite a lot more, and it is what I kind of, well, my profession is, so to speak. I'm what's called a trails guide, a lead trails guide, which basically means trails, obviously walking. So doing a lot of walks down big river lines like the Olifant River, which flows through the Kruger National Park here. But of course, driving, each of them's got their perks. Driving, I can do this. I can sit 5 meters away from a line and they're going to be very comfortable. Obviously walking, being 5 meters away from a lion, you're either going to end up in hospital or the lion's just going to run away. So both of them have their perks. Obviously being on a bushwalk, which I'm sure if you guys have followed the show before, we try and focus more on the smaller things that's out there, like your millipedes, your little spiders. Sometimes you get things like snakes, and then even just, you don't always have to have things that are living in that sense with a heartbeat, even just smaller things like flowers and things like that that's out there, especially after the rain that we've had. So both of them have their perks, but to answer your question, James, yes, I do prefer walking a bit more. But driving, I mean, it's like saying, what do I like more, a Lamborghini or a Ferrari? Obviously I'm gonna like both of them, but just maybe a little bit more leaning towards the Lambo. Okay, guys, so we're going to say cheers to these young little cubs having a little cuddle with mommy over there and get back to James and see what he's up to.
We're playing a game of hide and go seek, everybody, with the common warthog. There it is. And I don't mean common in the same way that you might describe somebody who's less than couth as common. I would describe this as common because he is the most common warthog. That one has not just been to the hair salon. It has been lying in a puddle of mud, which, of course, as we all know, for pigs, is the best possible way to spend your day. And it's just got up and decided that it's sufficiently cool as the sun starts its inexorable movement off to the west to get out of its little mud wallow. There it is. Isn't that nice? And it's going to wander off with its, I think probably its mother has gone off beyond it. Isn't that sweet? And like I say, everything today that we've seen, it just conspires to increase my impression of this day as being magnificently beautiful. It's just very peaceful. There's that lovely sound of crickets and grasshoppers going tick, 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 tick in the background, the gentle wind coming from the southeast. Oh, it's wonderful. David agrees with me. He's been nodding vigorously when I say things like that. Anyway, I know there are some lions at the damn camera, everybody, but we're just going to have a little squiz around here from where we had those warthogs, not warthogs, but we had some baboons calling over here, and we'll just see if they haven't perhaps spotted Karula. I suspect she's left both of those cubs in the culvert there, and she's come off hunting again. And I think that's why they're not coming out. And I think it was around about here that we heard the baboons alarming. So the best thing to do now is to look for tracks, but of course because of the rain, there's a rather rock-hard surface on the ground and it's difficult to tell if there's been any kind of movement. Don't see anything there. We'll carry on going, I think, to the north a little bit. And the baboons may have been calling all the way in the east on Cheetah Cut Line. They make that tremendously, completely unmistakable barking call. I'm going to do it for you now, David. Are you ready? Bow! Bow! What do you think, Dave?
Right.
Have you been deafened? A little bit deafened. That's why I warned you, see, it's because I'm very nice. Extremely kind human being. Now, what I just want to do, I know that every single presenter on Safari Live has stopped at this skull at least 784 times, but I'm going to make my 785th stop here simply to show you and link to this morning where we had a question about how fast or why it is that we don't see bones all over the place. Kurula! Now, we don't see bones all over the place because bones decay. And what I wanted to show you here is that, I mean, this thing is now what? It's probably about a year old. And it's starting to decay. You can see the horns are starting to go away. They're going to disappear. And then after the rainy season, of course, it's not the rainy season. Well, it is the rainy season now, but this thing hasn't survived through a full proper rainy season. It'll be interesting to see how much is left of it by the end of this particular rainy season. David always tells me I need to move the skulls around when I hold them to make the shot dynamic. How am I doing, Dave?
Good. Keep going.
Thank you. I'll do my best. Let me plug myself back in again so that Kirsten can continue to shout at me. And there we are. Oops. Well, I do not see any sign of a baboon. So I think they were probably further east of where we are now. It was slightly wishful thinking that they were close to where we are. Anyway, time will tell. Just need to listen to the radio because I need to guide the vehicles into where Christopher is. Because it's a little difficult to do that on your first drive. There. Hello, Kristen in North Carolina. Kristen? You want to know what language I was speaking to Aubrey. The language I was speaking is a language called Xitsonga, and there's a sort of local dialect of it called Shangane or Shangan. And that's what it is. It's a beautiful language, I think. And not an easy one to learn if you have no sort of experience of African languages. Thankfully, I did one at school, so it wasn't that dreadfully bad to learn, but although to a non-Shangan speaker I sound like I'm fluent, can you see him there, Dave? He's gone, yeah. Never mind. To a non-Shangan speaker I sound like I'm speaking very well, but to a Shangan I sound like a white man doing his very best. Which is okay, but the point is that I don't speak it particularly well. It is green and verdant and lovely. And while I am driving through here feeling filled with the joy of life, a general bonhomie for my fellow man and creatures around me, let us head back to Christopher and his lions.
So from the majestic lilac-breasted roller to cute little cub suckling, what a afternoon, eh? I tell you guys what, I've grown up in the bush, I've worked in various places, but to see these youngsters, just the interaction, you guys have been away from us now for a little while, having a little fight over the teats there, it's just absolutely amazing to see, eh? Very, very good mother. She's not worrying too much. Obviously, these youngsters have started developing teeth. I'm assuming, just looking at the size, that they're probably about two and a half, probably going on to 3 months. Still very, very small, but the teeth would have already started developing sharp little baby teeth. Each trying to get a nipple there and try and get as much milk as possible out of mommy. She's being extra, and she's just kind of looking over her shoulder every now and then, making sure we're not coming any closer to her babies. Karen from Texas. Good question once again. Getting some lovely questions coming through today. Do oxpeckers tend to bother the lions? And I'll tell you what, they generally don't tend to bother them because they're generally not on them most of the time. And you can think, well, if I was an oxpecker flying around, and I can, obviously these oxpeckers feed off of ticks, parasites, and also the blood. Often when there's a wound, they open it up and try and get the blood through. So actually kind of vampire birds, which is quite scary to think about. But no, they don't really bother them because, like I said, if you think about it, why are you going to be an oxpecker flying around trying to go to the biggest cat in Africa, eat a couple of ticks off of him or her, if you can just go to an impala 100 meters away that's absolutely harmless and go get some ticks off of that? So Karen, no, they typically do not bother the lions, mainly because I assume they have a bit of a fear of them, and again, they don't want to risk their life going sitting on a lion's head if they can just go to an impala or a buffalo or something like that. Thank you, Karen. There we go. From the one mummy to the next mummy. It looks like it is daycare time now. Everyone's just lying down, having a bit of milk, suckling. These other youngsters on the left over here are not looking too pleased that mommy walked away. She said, "That's enough now, guys." And he's just kind of playing hide and seek with us behind the tree there. Getting a bit of a breeze starting to come through here, and I'm sure these lions are appreciating it just as much as me and Brian over here. We've been sweating away, but let's call it a pleasurable sweat. I absolutely can be out here the whole day looking at this with you guys. Now, I'm not sure if they've named this little youngster. Maybe you guys out there can help me with this by posting it online. Does this little youngster have a name? Because I personally would call him Mr. or Mrs. Floppy. I actually do think it is a female. Look at that floppy little ear there. Unfortunately from the mange, but like I say, their condition does seem to be getting better from what the other guards are saying. And just me personally, an outsider coming in, it really isn't a severe, severe condition of manges. Oh, hello, sister. That tuba guy, we're back with you again. I'm loving all the questions coming from you. My most memorable or favorite little experience that I've had out here in the bush. Once again, a bit of a tough one. I've had various things. Obviously, everyone likes to see a kill and some dramatic things like that. So therefore, I'm actually going to go down that road. Hope I'm not disappointing any of you. But it is quite a spectacular thing what I saw. It is basically where I worked before in the south of the park, almost right at the south, close to the Crocodile River, if you guys kind of know a bit of the geology of the area. It was collision of three cheetahs. Now, as you guys know, most of your cats are actually solitary, except for, of course, our lions over here, which is very, very social. And then cheetah is kind of the bit of the exception, because with cheetah, what you're going to have is the males end up forming collisions. And we were very, very lucky where I worked there. We actually had a resident collision of three male cheetahs, fully grown, massive cats that we could almost follow every day, like we follow the lions and things down here. One day just going out again, now obviously they like to hunt on these big open plain areas. We went out early morning, kind of got a couple of rhinos and things down there, very, very lovely morning to start off with. And then kind of coming on the horizon, we saw these three boys coming. So we kind of braced ourselves. I said, "Guys, this is one of the most endangered species. Just sit back and relax." And before my words were even cold, they just kind of burst straight into a sprint and actually took down an impala straight in front of us, which was quite spectacular to see. You know, these cheetahs, they can actually reach speeds up to 110 kilometers an hour. I'm not sure what that is in miles. please do excuse me. I wasn't the greatest in maths, but I do know a thing or two about animals. But yeah, about 110 kilometers an hour. I'm not always reaching that speed, depending on what the situation is. Obviously, not being able to maintain that speed for a very long time. But those quick bursts, and we basically saw a burst like that, and they did that typical. I'm not sure if you've seen it on television, or maybe personally one of you guys have seen it. Did that typical ankle tap, and this impala just went stumbling. And yeah, three of them had a nice meal for the day. That was absolutely amazing for me to see. I've only seen it once in my life. I'm 23 years of age, living and growing up in the bush, and I've only seen that once. So quite a moment for me. Oh, it looks like that youngster's actually... he's not sleeping. I thought he fell asleep for a second there, suckling away. So now what you'll have with these lions, they've got a very, very short gestation period, about anything between, I'd say, about 110 to 120, let's average on 115 days gestation period, which is dramatically short if you compare it to other things this general size. But generally the rule is, you know, for every advantage, there's a disadvantage. So mom isn't stuck with this youngster in the belly for that long, but then she's stuck with this youngster suckling away for quite a long time, even up to 7-8 months. They will be suckling sometimes. Obviously, it starts slowing down as they get older, and mom will stop producing as much milk, and they'll actually start doing the transition from milk to meat. Like I've said earlier, we could actually see some blood on one of the youngster's faces, and he couldn't have been anything more than 5 months, 5 to 6 months, and he's already started feeding on that carcass. But yeah, quite a long time that mommy is going to be stuck with this youngster doing exactly what he's doing now, trying to find the nip there, which I can't imagine being a lot of fun. So Ash, you got a question. What is my most favorite thing about being a guide? And I think it is absolutely just doing what I am doing right now. Being out here, listening to Cape Turtle doves calling in the background, being surrounded by, 10 to 12 lions. I can't see anyone that loves nature that would find a job any better than this. So that is my answer. It is basically just being out here with the animals, being able to spend time with them and just watch their behavior, just learn from them. You know, some people like to sit in New York's in Times Square in New York and just watch people for a hobby. I do actually know friends like that, and if you are watching, you know who you are. But I like to sit out here in nature and just kind of analyze and study the animals. So yeah, just being out here is personally my favorite thing. And I do also like people. I love explaining things to people and trying to get a message through. Now obviously I'm talking to a camera at the moment, but I know I'm getting through to you guys. So I do love that as well. Just basically passing knowledge, what I know about these animals, over to you guys. Not sure if you guys can hear all these bird calls around. We have that Cape Turtle dove calling. We have a magpie shrike, which is a beautiful bird. We'll see if we can maybe get a couple of birds once we leave the lions here. Yeah, it's just a lovely, lovely afternoon this is turning out to be. Aaron from Kiwiland, nice to get another one from the Southern Hemisphere asking some questions. Do I keep a bird list? And the answer is, of course I do. I must say, I'm going to be dead honest, I haven't been updating that list as much as I should be. And I know I have actually seen some new birds, especially with our latest trip through Southern Africa, Botswana and Namibia. I've gotten a little bit lazy, but of course I do keep a bird list. You know, when you're out here in nature, it always starts with the bigger things, the big five, and then you kind of go to the dangerous nine, and then you know, you try and you kind of start knowing everything about that, and it starts scaling down to trees, and then it starts going to birds. So you can't always just have the big things, and then you get a massive interest in the smaller things like the birds. So obviously it is becomes a bit of a challenge to try and tick everyone and beating your best mate, your ranger mate, to see who's going to get the most birds. And just as a personal thing as well, you know, birds are fascinating things, and just trying to kind of test your knowledge a bit. There is way more birds out here than there is actual mammal or reptiles or things like that. Yeah. So I do, and I hope you do the same, Aaron, if you are watching this show, and I hope you're coming along with it very well. Thank you. See what this youngster wants to do. He looks a bit undecisive. Lie down again. Now, I'm going to tell a very horrible joke right now. So where do lions get their name, guys? And I believe personally this is where they get their names: lie in. Always kind of crack myself up with that one, because this is what they're doing most of the time during the day. But it makes absolute sense for them to do this. They're trying to conserve energy. There's no reason for them to go running around trying to hunt things during the day, whereas at night time they've got such excellent eyesight and they can go hunt something or move around. So this is what they do, just kind of lie in. Righty, got another question coming through. Seems like you guys are loaded with questions at the moment, which I'm absolutely loving. Gremlin the General, I hope that's right, once again. Your question is, have I ever had a dangerous encounter? Of course I've had a dangerous encounter. Spending all this time, if this is your career, your profession, you're out here every single day, every morning, every afternoon, and sometimes even during the day, trying to track down animals. If you can't find your clients, anything, you need to find them something, that's why they're here. So I'll tell you a quick little story again. I'll try not to make it too long so we can go back on the focus on these beautiful cats. And I'm going to relate this to lions. Once again, working in the south of the park, driving along, haven't found lions for about 2 days. So we kind of tracking. I had my tracker on the front seat over there. He started telling me Ngala Nkonzo, Ngala Nkonzo, which means lion tracks in Shongaan, one of our local languages here. So I said, fantastic, let's keep following them. They kind of went down the road. And then typically, as cats, lions and leopards and things like that do during the heat of the day, they went down kind of into a drainage, so a dried up riverbed is what I'm talking about. That's one of the number one rules as a guide, so I'm kind of embarrassing myself on camera here at the moment, is to never, ever, ever, first of all, anything with cubs, with youngsters, follow them around on foot, especially because of course moms are going to be quite protective. But I was having a bit of a brain fart that day and just obviously very excited to get these cats. I did have my rifle with me. I didn't use it. I don't particularly like to have a rifle with me ever. So I left it on the vehicle. I told my tracker, let's hop off, let's follow these tracks. And without thinking, you know, it is a dry riverbed, which means it's normally quite thick, a bit more thick cover, trees growing there because it is an underground water source flowing there, obviously. So not thinking very clearly, just being quite excited to get these lions. We kind of meandered down this riverbed, and the next thing, similar to this little youngster Brian was just focusing on, probably about two and a half months, just popped up his head, maybe about 8-9 yards from me, and I knew straight away there's big trouble coming. There's no way his mom will be anywhere far away from a youngster of that age. So it wasn't even 1 or 2 seconds, and I first had one lion nest, which I predict was the actual mom for that cub, coming straight at me. It is deathly terrifying. They're trying to intimidate you, so it is very noisy, it is very loud, coming at me. Probably stopped maybe 4 yards from me, unbelievably close. I promise you, I was shaking. Went back, and typically as lions do, you know, we don't just turn around and run away. We kind of stood our ground, and as lions do, came back. But this time it wasn't just one lioness. It ended up being 4 lionesses, which is something I've never experienced in my life, except for that time. It was terrifying. 4 lionesses coming. Thankfully, all of them stopping. Turning around, I was telling James, my tracker at the time, just make as much noise as possible, try and be intimidating back. And then once they kind of started settling out, we moved off slowly, slowly, obviously keeping our eyes on them. As soon as we turn our heads and start moving, we're going to become the prey. So keeping our eyes on them and slowly, slowly backing off. I tell you what though, I got back in the vehicle, the guests weren't too far away, so their eyes was this big, and asking Chris what's going on. And I said, oh, I had a little small encounter with the lion standing there shaking like this. Got back in the vehicle. I didn't get back straight in the vehicle. I first walked about 2 times around the vehicle. For what reason, I do not know. Obviously, just the nerves. But then got back into the vehicle, started the engine, and I just wanted to get out of there. I said on the radio, please, it's a negative lock, guys. Don't come here. These lions are not very happy at the moment. And then had a bit of an embarrassing stall with my vehicle because my foot on the clutch wasn't doing too well. It was kind of going... So yeah, it was quite a terrifying moment. It wasn't the only one I had, but it was definitely up there in the top 3, I'll tell you. Amazing to think after the story I just told you that that cute little face can turn into something completely terrifying. Obviously not at that age. The story I just told, the youngster actually looked very surprised, obviously, but very happy to see me. And obviously mommy wasn't as happy as the youngster was. Alrighty guys, so I think what we're going to do from here, we're going to give these time guys a bit of peace and quiet, and I'm going to bumble over to the kill site over there, and for now we'll head back to James and see what all kind of interesting things he's getting up to.
One second. Oh. We're on our way, everybody, towards the Juma Dam, just to see if we can't find that male and female lion. Likewise, we're then going to head towards the western boundary, where Andrew has found Shadow. Now, I haven't seen Shadow for some time. I've been very worried that she was actually still existed at all. So let's go and have a look at her and see if we can't piece a few more bits of her rather tragic tale together. I found the baboons eventually, but they weren't calling anymore. They were sitting very relaxed, so I don't know where Karula is. I'm sure she's around that area somewhere, probably hunting, and she will go and fetch the cubs once she's killed a hapless bushbuck or perhaps an impala again. She's such a great huntress. So we'll pop up towards where the lion and the lioness are. Hello, David. You're wondering if the baboons we get here are the Chacma baboon. They are indeed the Chacma baboon. That is correct. And they're a different... I don't think they're a different species. They're a different sort of subspecies from the olive baboon, which you get up in East Africa, or the yellow baboon, which you find in Zambia. And that's along the Zambezi. But they're both roughly... they're all roughly the same size, and I'm pretty sure they can interbreed with each other. I'm just going to check that for you in case I'm telling you a foul and contemptible untruth. Do you think I am, David?
No.
You wouldn't accuse me of that, would you, David?
No.
Well, while I embarrassedly look in my book, why don't you show our very fine viewers that very fine elephant's bottom?
Go, Andrew. That's my reading.
I'm just going to quickly find... That's not the best elephant sighting, but it is an elephant sighting. And we must not look a gift elephant in the mouth, must we, David? Wasn't that a hilarious joke I just made? Sorry, everybody. I apologize. I'm just paging through thousands of different primates you get in Africa. Most of them with the distressing-looking bottoms, I must say. Right, here we go. The olive baboon is not the same species as the yellow baboon, and in turn is not the same species as the chacma baboon. And in fact, you get 5 different baboon species in Africa. There they are. You get the sacred baboon, which is that one there, that apparently looks sacred. I think it just looks terrifying. Then you get the Guinea baboon, which is quite possibly the ugliest bottom in Africa. Remember, we were looking for that earlier. That's the olive baboon that you find in East Africa. There's the chacma baboon, which looks nothing like that at all. And there's the yellow baboon, which I think is the slightest of the species. It's a more sort of long-distance marathon runner of the baboon species. Yeah, and that's the last of the baboons. So 5 baboon species. Thank you for that question. It's wonderful always to get questions that we don't really know the answer to, as long as we then find out what the answer was, because that's how we learn. Sorry, hang on a second. That elephant's coming towards us now. Not at high speed. Ooh, this is wonderful. He is a very big bull elephant, this. Right, everybody, I think it's only Andrew left at that sighting, so we're going to make our way there as soon as we decide what this elephant's intentions are. But it's always so lovely to spend time with these great giants. I think he's in must. Oh, he's certainly showing signs of it. You see how he's flopping his trunk over his tusks. He's a big fella, this, 35 years plus. I wonder if he's as old as me, David. He's certainly bigger than me, though, isn't he? He's been in the mud, and he's definitely coming to see us. There's no reason for... Oh, look at this. He's now going to show us how big and strong he is. We are under no illusions, my friend. We know that you are big and strong. Isn't that wonderful? He's now about 25 meters from us. It's about 100 feet or so. Now he is starting to show signs of must. We might have to drive away at some stage, but he's not showing any signs of aggression. I'll just let him walk past. I think he's okay. He's not leaking any of that urine. My heart rate has gone up slightly. In fact, it's gone up quite a lot. How's yours, David? This elephant is now 2 meters from us. Excuse me not looking at you, everybody. I'm kind of distracted. You are a very fine fellow. Slow movements, David, slow movements. Do not pull that tree onto us. Dana, you want to know how fast an elephant can run? I'm going to answer your question once this situation has reduced slightly. I'm overawed, I'm afraid. I can't really think right now. He's not displaying any signs of aggression, but he is massive. This is a 10-ton animal, everyone. He's just feeding quietly. The dust from his mouth is blowing off onto us. He's smelling us and listening and deciding if we are a threat. I don't think he thinks of us as a threat at all. I think he's actually just searching for company, to be honest. If he starts to pull that tree over, I'm going to just reverse. Oh my goodness. He might try and show us how strong he is. This is astounding. Don't do it, come on. You don't need to do that. And the next one. Okay, we might have to move here. No? Yes. Sorry, my friend, but you're about to push that onto the car. It's not that I wish to leave you. You can carry on now. Go on, then. You see how cross he was that we didn't want to watch him push the tree over. That's why we moved. He was so irritated with us that we didn't stay for the show. All right, everybody, it's not going to get better than that right here. Let's go and see if we can't have a look at Shadow. Was that not too spectacular?
Amazing.
You're right, though.
Yeah.
We're just going to clean the bits of knobthorn tree off the car. Davey, that was amazing. And so you were asking how fast they run. I forget your name. I'm sorry about that. Dina, I think it was. You want to know how far they run? How fast they run? Probably about 45 to 60 kilometers an hour. Probably about 45, roughly. Maybe 50. And that's about 35 miles an hour, which is faster than a human being can run. There's a herd of elephants just up ahead here. There's some there. Just going to get... There's another little one over here. Phew! That was spectacular. My heart rate is not low, but not because he showed us any form of aggression. And it's such a wonderful understanding while we look at this little one who will one day be that big, hopefully. It's a sense of, if that elephant wanted to, he could destroy us, but there was never a sense that that's what he wanted to do. He didn't shake his head. He didn't open his ears out at us. He just almost came to make friends. And then he showed us how strong he was. Got a little bit upset when I moved away from having the tree put on David's head. And then he carried on. And you notice that when we turned the car on to leave, he didn't even turn round. It was only when we went very close to him and he thought, well, what are you doing? Why are you leaving now? That he turned to face us. Gee whiz. I hope you enjoyed that, everybody. It really was something special. All right, let's go back to the lions with Christopher. I'm going to head as fast as I can towards the west and see if we can't find the tragic figure of Shadow.
So I believe, whilst I've been sitting here, that you guys are all constantly staring at my favourite animal there, the elephant. So I'm very happy for James and you guys for what you've seen there. And apparently on the prowl for Shadow, another leopard that I've never even heard about or seen about. So I do hope you guys get that. Back here with us, lions are still taking it very, very easily. One lioness is kind of moving between the kill and the youngsters over there. Not sure, maybe she's a bit worried because it is basically still a full buffalo that something else is going to come and try and snatch a bite from there. So if we move now just forward further to our north here, Brian will show you where the actual kill is. And there we can see. There we go. Not a very alive buffalo lying over there. Oh, look at that, covered in flies. Open eye. And as you can see, not much eating that's been done there. And that is because, like I've mentioned before, animals are very weak and they're getting nailed left, right and center. There we go. There where most of the flies are, where the camera is focusing now, is probably where they've been doing much of the eating. So I'm going to go a bit closer and I want to talk to you guys about a couple of killing techniques that these lions use, especially on buffalo, because it is definitely the most dangerous animal out here that they do try and take down. And I have personally seen how a lion gets flicked about 2-3 meters through the air by buffaloes. They are very, very protective species, normally found in massive herds, and tend to really, really protect each other. Even once one is down, I've seen before, you'll get a couple of the big bulls or sometimes the whole herd even just kind of stampeding through there, which is obviously extremely dangerous to these lions. So I'll chat to you now about a couple of the techniques. I'm just going to move a bit closer so you and myself can have a bit of a closer look at what's going on there, and we'll see how the lions actually took down this female buffalo. Just turning out to be such a lovely afternoon. Temperature has dropped now. We're going to have a look at this buffalo and then probably go for a little bit of a bumble. I'm quite keen to see what the rest of the reserve is looking like. And then from there, probably come back here. I'm pretty confident they'll come at some stage to feed you again. So I'm just looking over the nose and mouth region there. Doesn't look like they actually suffocated and killed it there. So let's just stop right over here. I hope there's no sensitive viewers watching, because this can be a bit of a disturbing sight, but this is the circle of life, you know. Some animals die and some survive. This is just how it goes. Alrighty, so if we look at the head over there, normally what they'll do is, especially if it's normally a big bull, nice big horns, very powerful neck, they try and normally pull it down, so they'll kind of have a bit of a fight, an attack with a jump on the back. The buffalo is going to kick them off, try again, and then eventually the buffalo is going to get so tired, especially conditions like this, not much water, not so much food, pull it down. And often you'll have some of them literally just holding down the buffalo, and then normally one of them will go right over the nostrils, over the you can actually, is that a hole there? That is a hole there. Can you see where that one fly is going into right now? So I'm assuming that is actually how they did kill it. They basically put their whole mouth over the nostril, the nose and the mouth region of the buffalo and just bite down as hard as possible. This is a very effective technique to use, because first of all, if they're just holding on there, the buffalo can't really with the horns get to the actual lion, because they're so powerful, these lions as well. And then also the lion can obviously now feel the breathing of the buffalo and can feel exactly when this buffalo stops breathing, and then know it is now safe to go and start feeding. Another technique that often gets used, if we just kind of focus more towards the hind area of this buffalo, I'm not exactly sure, I'm predicting they took it over the mouth and nose there to suffocate it, but just like you see here, start feeding from behind. Very typical behavior for your lions to do that, pull it down and start feeding from behind. I've actually seen it a couple of times where lions take down buffalo, where they actually start, it's quite gruesome, eating this buffalo from behind whilst it's still alive. And why from behind? Just personally, right between the legs, that is some of the softer skin there to break through and actually start getting to the meat, and also it's away from the weapons, the massive horns that the African or Cape buffalo has got. So they've started eating from behind there. Everyone's a bit full-bellied, all of those youngsters and lion nest, they are looking very full, but I'm pretty confident they'll come back later. The meat looks very rotten there, but that's not actually meat, that is just a little bit of leftover kind of flesh and meat that's there on the bone. But as they go in, this buffalo was killed, we believe, very early this morning, probably between 3 and 4 a.m. this morning. So there's still nothing wrong. Yeah, these lions can definitely still dig in and have a feast. There we go, you can see the hoof there of the buffalo. Now something that's quite, what's the English word for it, quite a specific, what would you call it, specific feature of buffalo is those dew claws, if you have a look there. So you've got the normal hoof in the front, and then just behind the hoof there, Brian's zooming in for us, that's the dew claws, which is a very specific feature for the buffalo. And it's quite important to know that if you're on foot doing trails, like we've mentioned before, I do, to kind of make sure not confuse it with another animal. The closest kind of track you're going to get to a buffalo there is going to be giraffe, but it's going to be a slightly longer track. There we go, perfect. Perfect photo there. Obviously those hooves aren't going to be doing much kicking anymore, but they do have quite a deadly kick on them. I actually also in the south of the park saw it's quite rare. Buffalo will normally try and defend themselves with their horns, their weapons, like I said. But I saw a young lion about the age of 2.5, 3, already basically fully grown, just not, doesn't have the big mane yet, but get kicked by one of these buffaloes in the skull completely indented. And we just kind of watched this lion deteriorate as time went by. Quite a sad sight, seeing an animal just going backwards and backwards and backwards, and eventually died right next to the road. So we've got another question coming through, asking what the dangerous nine is. Very good question. If you don't know what it is, obviously you want to know. So the dangerous nine is the potentially nine most dangerous animals that we can encounter out here, and that has obviously unfortunately killed a couple of people before. So I'm just going to make it very basic. The big five, which most of you should be familiar about by now, let me just quickly run through it. So you're going to have your cat, you're going to have your lion, your leopard, obviously, and then you're going to have your buffalo, normally a live one when they're dangerous, and then you're going to have the rhino. In fact, the black rhino is the true big five, but now we kind of, as guys, just say rhino, because I'm sure as you, most of you guys will know, the black rhino is very, very endangered. We're talking at about 900 that's only left in the whole of the Kruger, which is an area about as big as Holland in size, which is very sad. But yeah, then our rhino, and then our last one over there is of course the elephant, my favorite, which you guys have seen just now, which is awesome. So then moving off from the big five, we have the hyena, the spotted hyena. We do get different species of hyena out here as well, with the spotted hyena, which is the bigger one. I'm sure you guys have seen it out here on Sabi Sands as well. I know there's a couple of dens out here, and the only reason it's really in there is because a lot of people, especially countries like Botswana, you can still freely as a tourist go and just sleep out in the bush in some of those areas. And of course, what do hyenas do? They scavenge. And if you're now sleeping, having a nice little nap there next to the fire, these hyenas are going to think, okay, maybe you're a dead piece of meat. And they do actually have the strongest jaws out of all our mammals out here. And one bite over the skull, it's going to be the ultimate end of you. So then we go, big five, hyena, the Nile crocodile. Only get two species of crocodile, your dwarf and your Nile out here. The Nile crocodile, obviously, I think is responsible for more deaths than the hippo, which is the next one that's on the dangerous nine. So there we go, spotted hyena, Nile crocodile, your hippopotamus, and I'm sure most of you have heard about that. Everyone always makes a big scene about it. Hippo kills just after the mosquito, obviously. Most humans out here in Africa, I'm not going to tell you my big theory and story behind it right now. Unless you ask me the question, then of course I will, but it is a bit of a story. I'm full of stories, I don't want to chat too much, so the directors are going to kick me off the show. So here we go, let's quickly backtrack. The big five: spotted hyena, Nile crocodile, hippopotamus, and why am I for some reason forgetting you? I'll be with you now in 1 second. Oh, the other rhino, of course. So your black and white rhino, and then those three. There we go, your dangerous nine. Alrighty, so we're gonna leave this kind of crime scene over here. I also want to go on a bit of a bumble, see what else we can find you guys, but we're going to head back to James, and I believe he's got some excitement going on that side. Enjoy it.
There, the tragic figure, everybody, of Shadow. And she's eating a little steenbok. Now, many of you might be asking the question, why Does this pillock who's talking to us say that she is tragic? Well, she's tragic, everyone, because she has never raised a cub to independence. And the more we've watched her, the more convinced I've become that she has got a hormonal imbalance and that she comes into estrus or heat much too soon after she's had a cub, and that causes her to reject the cubs that she's had. And I think that's what the problem is. And there are many who will disagree with me, but I think that's what it is. She does, if in case any of you haven't been watching for long, have one son called Sindile. And Sindile is alive, I believe, only because we took him out of the reserve. Well, we didn't, but the Sabi San did, because he caught a rabid dog one day, and in order to make sure that he didn't get rabies, he was inoculated and then kept in quarantine for 6 months, 7 months I think it was actually. And I think that's the only, he was then re-released, and I think that's the only reason that he is still extant. Anyway, this is the daughter of Karula, who we were looking for earlier, her oldest daughter at 9 years old. She must be almost 10. I don't know when her birthday is, but one of our viewers who knows these leopards extremely well will tell us when her birthday is. And I know many of you are very thrilled to be seeing her, and I'm rather thrilled too. It's been a long time since I've seen her. Okay, I think let's move around a little bit because she's really not her best angle. What an afternoon. Just beautiful. We've been so lucky. That elephant was quite something. I'm still coming off the high. Everybody, just do yourselves a favour. David is going to very subtly show you the size of the cannons on the end of that car. There we are. Look at all of them. There we go. How's that, Dave? Is that any good to you? I'll go back a little. There we go. A little bit more. It's a little steenbok, I think. Not a big steenbok. And so roughly the same size as the one that... Okay, Aubrey says there's a better view from just around the other side there. Roughly the same size as the duiker that Karula had earlier. There is some serious camera equipment on the back of that car. I hope there's some award-winning shots being taken there. Hold on, everyone. Dragonflies all over, adding to the wonderful summer atmosphere of the afternoon. Possible storm in the offing. Me making a giant noise with this car. Ba-bang, bang, bing. How's that going, Davy? Is that any good to you? There we are. Right, there we go. She looks like she's going to be sick. Wonderful. Now, the other reason, everyone, that we think Shadow, well, one of the theories proffered for why she's lost her cubs, that she doesn't hoist her kills very often, in fact hardly ever, and I don't believe that's got anything to do with it, to be honest. So the theory being that because she doesn't hoist her kills, she comes to feed her cubs on the ground, and that means that they're always at risk from hyenas. Lisa Lee, you're in Ohio wondering about inbreeding and whether I think that's one of her problems. No, I don't think that at all. As far as I'm aware, well, her Sindhile's father, we think, was Tingana or Anderson or Mvula, none of whom are related to her. I think Mvula is very distantly, but very distantly. Then the youngster, or the her last cub, who she's just lost, or lost about 2 months ago probably, when she started mating with Tingana again, was Tingana's cub, we think. And it could have also been Anderson's, but we're not sure. We only met it once, twice. I think Jamie saw it twice, once, and Brent saw it the other time. And so I don't think inbreeding's the issue at all, no. I think it's because she comes into estrus so soon after they're born. Although this isn't the best view of a leopard, it is quite an interesting one, isn't it? To see where she's hidden the kill. And I mean, there's no reason at all that she shouldn't take a kill that size into the tree. And she's in good nick, you know, she's in very good condition. And bearing the coat, of course, of this very pale lineage. They're very honey-coloured, these leopards. And by this lineage, of course, I mean Karula's lineage. And in case you are a new viewer, her other sister, or her sister, Tandi, from the same litter, obviously also 9 years old, is lurking about in the eastern regions of our traversing area. Beautiful. And there she's just cutting the skin off the meat there with the carnassial teeth. I think there are a few new viewers, and I always like to say this to people who don't know what a carnassial tooth is. Many of you have a cat or dog at home, and provided it's not going to bite you, if you do this, grab it now and peel the back of its lips back, and you'll see how its teeth close over each other. The bottom ones closing over the top ones, under the top ones, like scissors. So they're not flat molars like ours. And again, the ubiquitous flies. If you look in there close, you can see all over the trees there are these beastly flies, and I think that they are the regal blowfly, from what I can tell. They've got those great orange eyes and turquoise starling-coloured bodies. Hello, Vicky. You're at work and watching the safari. That's excellent. I always advise people who are at work to watch the safari, especially if you're in a meeting, which is bound not to achieve anything anyway. Just definitely have it on the desk in front of you on your phone and just... Oh, no, I've got... Vicky, you say, where did we find Shadow? We didn't, unfortunately. Andrew found her. He was just driving up the Triple M break. Now, that's the road that leads to Simbambili. So across the road, about 30 metres or so, Simbambili. So that's where she is. And she's very close to the northern gate. And I think maybe she's been spending a bit of time on Simbambili, and that's why we haven't been seeing her. But, of course, we haven't been to Arethusa for a while. A little bit restless. She keeps looking around, and I suspect she's been eating here for some time. I'm just going to get hold of Ephraim. Now you'll hear the machine gun fire of the photographic crew behind us. It is not, in fact, an invasion from the Zimbabwean army. It is just one camera full, at least a vehicle full of cameras. She's heading into Juma, which is excellent news. I always just feel very sorry for the amount of editing that has to go on after that. Right, let's just get out of the way, yeah. Excellent. She's going straight into Juma. That's fantastic. Right, while we reposition, let's head back to Christopher. I'm not sure where he is. He's left the lions. Let's go and find out how his exploring, and his genuinely exploring, of Juma is going.
So I believe you guys just had a awesome sighting there with James. Leopard once again taking down something. It seems like everything on Sabi Sands is just kills left, right and center. It is absolutely amazing. So we're doing a bit of a bumble around now. I've just been seeing some amazing bird life already. If we just have a look right here, we've got some Egyptian geese just to the right here, and just above where they're walking now, we got a bird of prey. Got some kind of eagle. It looks like a Walbrook just from this distance. There he goes. I'll have a look now with my binoculars. Hopefully it gives us some time. Come on, buddy, take a seat. Very, very, very good camera work going on here. I'm thoroughly impressed. Ooh, that was almost a hit and miss. Come on, buddy, you're gonna show yourself to us. There we go. I'm gonna try and have a look. It's a little bit far, even with the binoculars, but just looking at that smile, it looks like a Warburg's eagle. And I do know you guys have a breeding pair around this area, which I'm sure you guys actually know more about than me. But that looks like a Warburg's, a dark morph of a Warburg's eagle. There we go, that head there. Not a very big eagle, one of the smaller ones, but they are very, very, very interesting hunters. Because they're not so massive in size like our bigger eagles, like our martial eagles, our snake eagles, these Warburgs, I have seen personally how they take birds out of the air, which obviously takes a lot of agility and skill to do. So they do have their advantages to being a little bit smaller. They are extremely agile and they move around. So they'll also now, as the sun is going down, obviously your bigger birds, your eagles, your vultures and things like that, they actually do enjoy the heat. They'll take those heat thermals going all the way up, and then they can start searching around for food, anything they're looking for. Whereas obviously your animals are trying to take it as easy as possible. You'll often see actually a very good birding day is when it's overcast and cool, a little bit like it was this morning, because like I've just explained, they'll normally be sitting around just kind of waiting for the heat. It's pointless trying to flap away, getting up 500 meters in the air when it's extremely cold and there's no heat thermals for them to catch. So what we're going to do is, we are starting to lose a bit of sun here, and I might still want to go pop by those lions and see if they're going to start feeding on that buffalo. I still want to go pop by the Juma Dam here, which I don't think I've actually been to before, so I'm quite excited about that, and see if there's any activity down there. It is a good time of the day for animals to go have a sip of water as the sun is going down, and then kind of find the area for the evening where they hopefully will be safe if they are something that can be preyed upon, or if they can go hunting. If they are actually the predator looking for what they want to get. There's actually a nice little water source just to the right here, and I'm sure that's why the Egyptian geese are hanging around. Birds that we have, these Egyptian geese, they actually can be seen as pests sometimes because they're so big and powerful. They often take over other birds' nests, such as some of our big owls, even your Verrows eagle owl, also known as your giant eagle owl, often take over hummercop nests. I'm not sure if you guys all know what these birds are that I'm mentioning, but it's basically birds that make quite big nests, and then these Egyptian geese will go and kind of take it over and sit on the top. Don't get confused by the name Egyptian geese. Just because they got the name Egyptian doesn't mean they are migrating birds going to Egypt and back quite a distance. They are just, I think it's got something to do with actually the colors of the feathers. They got quite nice colors going through there. Not 100% sure, but I do know they do not migrate to Egypt. Cindy from Hong Kong. Lovely, lovely, lovely to hear from you. I believe I got you at Lukumbi. It does ring a bell. I obviously have worked with hundreds and hundreds of different guests, but what a nice surprise. And thank you for tuning into the show. Absolutely awesome to hear from you. And I hope you are doing very well there in Hong Kong. And I do hope you're going to come visit us down here in South Africa again to see some of the wildlife we have having around here. Thanks again, Cindy. Very nice to hear from you. And maybe we'll have a little chat on Facebook later. I have a bit of a giggle, so funny. Never know. Small world, how you bump into people again, eh? Alrighty, let's see what wants to show themselves to us. I can almost guarantee you guys we will see impala before we get back to the lions over there. I'm a man with promises. Hopefully I can deliver. Ooh, look what we have right here. See, too much chatting, too little looking. Look at that, guys. Some beautiful elephants right here on the road. You see, now this is the type of traffic I particularly love. Not the ones you find in Johannesburg and Cape Town, our two bigger cities. This is my kind of traffic. Some elephants standing right in the road, blocking our way. What I'm going to do is I'm going to go a bit more forward. We don't want to disturb him too much. I'm just going to pop up here to the right so you guys can have a nice clear view there. There we go. Hey boy, have you come to say hello to me? I know you heard what I said earlier. You guys are my favorite. Just enjoying the nice fresh leaves here. Obviously all your mass grazers, as we call them, that needs to eat plenty, is just loving it at the moment. There's just so much greenage around here. It's even making me extremely happy. That's looking actually very tasty right there. Hey buddy. You can just see it on their face. I always say you can tell an elephant's emotion from the eye. Just look how big and happy that eye is looking. When they get angry, they kind of get more. Ooh, there goes a tree. So let's see, Brian's gonna quickly take us there. As the sun is setting, look at that, eh? Now that is Africa, ladies and gentlemen. Bit cliche what I'm saying here, but that is really Africa. Beautiful sunset, elephants smashing over trees, eh? So that bull that Brian is busy focusing on right now, you can't see him too well. He is hiding a little bit behind the bushes over there. There we go. He is a little bit bigger than the one we're focusing on just now. G Monster, very good question. I believe your question is, how long can elephants live? Now, it's a very good question, and it isn't actually determined. Well, first of all, let me give you a bit of a time span. We're generally looking at about 60 years. They do generally, out of our bigger mammals, live the longest, but their lifespan isn't really determined by much else than their molars, their teeth. Now, just like humans, we get two sets of teeth. Obviously, you get your baby teeth, you get your adult teeth. These elephants actually go through six sets of molars as they go through their lifetime. Now, like I just said, they are mass feeders, so they are constantly eating away, like we see these two are doing. Whenever you see elephants, they're busy feeding, and I'm sure you guys have seen that as well. So these molars get worn down and down and down. As they get worn down, the next set starts pushing through, and then eventually, normally it's very tough to say, it depends on the vegetation where the elephant is, but normally around about the age between 35 and 45, I've found mostly before, that last set of teeth starts getting worn down and worn down. And this actually links to the myth that elephants have these graveyards, because now what happens is, you can imagine, if your teeth is extremely sensitive, you're kind of almost getting to the gum, where you're going to move to get more softer eating material, you're going to move to water sources, obviously. So you're going to try and move more towards your riverine areas, to some big natural dams or things that's around, where you're generally going to find softer eating material. And that is where they normally end up, unfortunately, dying. And you can say, sadly enough, normally from starvation. The teeth is nothing more to mold down and eat what they're grabbing, and they normally end up dying of starvation. And this is what kind of leads to the myth of an elephant graveyard, because where you're going to find most of your elephant bones now is obviously along your riverine areas. So I hope that answers your question. About 60 years on average for elephant bull. Or elephants in general, not just the bull. You can see he's just loving that knobthorn over there. It also actually looks like a knobthorn that got pushed over from the other side. A little bit tough. There we go. Brian's zooming out a bit for us over there. That is a very low-level knobthorn if it was one to be that height. So I can tell you guys we'll drive past it just now once this youngster has moved on. That's the tree that got pushed over. But obviously still a couple of roots attached because that tree you can see has just got some new shoots that's coming out. Lime green, yummy leaves for this young bull over here. So also elephants, you know, people always say they're pushing over trees. They're doing so much damage. I like to argue that fact, because now what happens if there's an impala, or what happens when there's a kudu, some of our other browsers coming along, there's now a level of feeding they would never have been able to reach if this tree was standing up tall. Now the elephants have pushed it, especially in dry conditions like that, boom, a new food source for our other little browsers. Now I was mentioning a little bit earlier how elephants are mass feeders, and they do, out of all our animals here, actually eat the most. There's some books and things say they eat up to 250 kilograms of food or vegetation a day. Now 250 kilograms, guys, that is about, let me do, my maths isn't very good, but that's about 4.5 of me an elephant eats per day. And I'll tell you why they eat that much. Firstly, obviously a massive animal, but secondly, they've got a very, very poor digestive system. They reckon, especially in dry times like this, only between 30 to 35% of what they eat actually gets digested. And that's why you'll actually even, there's still so much nutrition in their poo when it comes out, you'll actually even get animals. It's not a very common thing, don't get me wrong, you're not going to see animals eating elephants' poo left, right and center, but it has been seen before. Very, very poor digestive system. They obviously love marula fruits. Now for those of you who know what marula fruit is, a little yellow fruit, almost very similar to a lychee, if you know what a lychee is. I'm sure you get them in the States and everywhere else. Elephants love them, I love them, baboons love them, but I've personally taken a marula fruit out of elephant dung, fresh dung, put it in my mouth and eaten it because it literally hasn't digested whatsoever. So not the best of digestive systems. Also another little visual fact that the elephant is giving us over there. This is what I love about nature, guys. It's just, you just watch these animals and they basically teach you by just watching them. So what I want you guys to watch now, come on, are you gonna do it for us, boy? Just keep an eye as we keep watching this bull. What they often do is they'll grab a branch with a trunk and then they use those tusks. That's what the tusks are there for. It's not just for fighting. It actually, very little is used for fighting. It's more for feeding. So they look at those beautiful tusks. You can see how much it's been worn out and been used. What they'll do is they take the trunk, grab a little piece, put it there, he's gonna do it over the tusk, boom, and snaps it. There we go. Look again, come on, there we go. Not the best of examples, but I'm sure you guys are getting the idea. So guys, we're gonna see if this bull maybe moves on. Well, he's just got a fresh marula, knobthorn tree there. I don't know if he's gonna move on too shortly, but I'm gonna head back over to James and we'll go see what he's up to. I do believe he could still possibly be with the leopard, so something to look forward to. And I believe he's eating a steenbok there. Lucky you guys. I kind of wish I was there as well. No complaints though. I always love seeing these magnificent elephants. I'll be back with you guys in a sec.
There's a leaf with some spiders in it and the inimitable shadow as the sun goes down. A fantastic sighting. David and I have been having a marvellous time with her. She's put her kill in a fallen down marula tree over there. We can just have a quick look, Dave. In there, a rather pathetic place to put it. I would hardly call it a hoist. In fact, I think a hyena could walk up there in seconds. Anyway, that's where she's put it. She's made a half-hearted attempt. Now she's just sitting there breathing very heavily. She's very full. Are you happy at this angle, David? There's a lot of machine gun fire coming from the other side. Do you think they've got a good picture? You think this is as good as we'll get? David reckons this is as good as we'll get. Yeah, now, we called her little cub Zara, or I did, simply because, of course, we called George and Charlotte. We called Hosan and Shongile George and Charlotte. And, Roger, you're wondering if Zara is no longer with us. I don't think Zara's with us. We're 99% sure that leopard is long dead, I'm afraid, on account of the fact that she was seen mating with Tingana many, many times. She could even be pregnant again. She's not lactating at all. Well, obviously, she wouldn't be, because Zara would be 8 months old. And we haven't seen her for, what is it, probably 2 or 3 months. So we're pretty sure that Zara is no longer. James, you're wondering about whether or not Shadow has mated with any other males other than Tingana. Not that I know of, James. I don't think she's been seen mating with any other leopards. And it's quite interesting. I think she has, certainly before she had Zara, I think she mated with Anderson and Tingana. Now, the Anderson male, of course, is the biggest male leopard that we get around here. And he has been, he is seen in the far west of Arethusa normally, and so he's kind of his territory. It's interesting, his territory doesn't actually encompass hers. Her territory is still in Tingana's territory, but it's not unusual for female leopards to go out of their territories in order to try and mate with other male. Now, just take a break from the leopard for me to tell you that on the one vehicle there's probably about, what should we say, $100,000 worth of equipment, of camera equipment. Then on the other vehicle that's come in, I just see somebody there with a tiny little point and shoot camera, and it must make her feel slightly, one of them is actually using a cell phone, which, of course, is a wonderful way to take pictures of your safari, unless you're sitting next to somebody with a 600mm lens. I haven't taken my camera out here. I'm too embarrassed. Ah, oh, she's gorgeous. David, I know you like the backlight, but do you want to try the other way?
Yeah.
Okay. We're going to try and get round the other side, everyone, so we can get her lit by the golden sun, but I quite like the way Davy likes the backlighting, I must say. I think it looks very nice indeed. She will, of course, roll over almost immediately we get to the other side. Watch out there, Dave. We don't have a spare tire, of course, so we can't really afford to take too many chances. Bethany, you ask a very good question. We'll just stop here and have one. No, we won't. We're going to keep going around. Bethany, you're wondering about whether or not Shadow could be pushed from her territory. Good afternoon. And yes, she could be pushed from her territory. It's unlikely, though. I know that everyone's thinking, where will Shongile set up home when she eventually goes independent? And I think the most unoccupied female territory is in the northern part of Karula's territory, so I think that's probably where it will be. But I don't think Shadow's not old. She's perfectly young enough to have a territory of her own still. David, again, I must ask you, don't say hi ever, don't ever do anything for you. Beautiful. Stunning. Magnificent. Now people are staring at me, everybody, because they think I'm mad. They think I'm talking to myself. But I don't mind, everyone. As long as I'm talking to you, you don't think I'm mad, do you? No. beautiful. Now, Monique, you're in London and wondering whether I think Shadow could be pregnant again. And, Monique, I absolutely do, you know. I think... excuse me. I think she could easily be pregnant again. In fact, I think it's quite likely. Oh, this is brilliant. Christopher is having a gem of an afternoon. He's got two larger cats, the gangsters of the bush.
Now, I'm sure everybody can agree with me that we are just having an absolutely magnificent afternoon from cat to cat to cat to cat. I believe you guys just had an amazing sighting there with the leopards. And we are back to completely different lines, not actually too far away from where the other ones were at. Sure, we're still going to probably go make a turn over there, but as we're stumbling around, we came across this nice big male lion over there and one lioness, just kind of really taking life easy. Lion in, as I said earlier, ha ha ha, Chris is full of jokes. Belly's in the air, look at that, eh? Beautiful. Now that is what we basically call the almost fully matured lion. You can see that mane, very, very big. We're going to get a bit of a zoom in there. Not a very, very dark mane compared to what I've seen before, but a very nice, big and decent mane already. If I have to predict his age, I obviously have got no idea what his age is, but probably anything close to about seven years or so. Not very dark yet, but of course that is genetical as well. Some lions almost never get a dark mane, so I'm not too sure. But he's definitely probably past the age of 5, 6, going on 7 to 8. Your male lions don't actually live extremely long, and it is because there's actually quite a lot of fighting that they go through in order to have a beautiful lady like that lying next to them. They normally average anything between 8 and 12 years. 10 years if a big male lion lives, 10, 11 years. That's a good age. Look at him. He's kind of looking at me saying, what you saying? I'm going to go 15 years. Oh, Robbie. I'm almost confident this is Robin McDonald. Or Robin Morris, I'm not too sure, but if it's from Hootsburg, probably Robin McDonald. And thank you to announcing it to the rest of the world out here. I am in fact what they call the Danger Ranger in the Hootsburg area. My brother actually made me my whole own shirt for my birthday and it became an official thing. So where did I get the name from, Danger Ranger? And Robin, I assume you're asking because I don't think I've ever actually told you. It actually came from a good friend of mine, Craig Reed, which I'm sure you are very familiar with and know as well. He's currently sitting in Dubai, and I do hope you are watching me as well, seeing as I'm now going famous with the name, Mr. Craig. It's nothing to do with me being dangerous, or is it? I'm not too sure. I'm not going to tell you guys the full story, but they call me Danger Ranger. That is my name. I've actually got a hashtag Danger Ranger with me riding elephants, kind of crawling under lions, things like that. That's where I got the name from. I'm just kidding, guys. It's not that at all. It's basically just a quote that came from one of my very good mates that I was fortunate enough to work with down in the south of the park, and it's now kind of flooded Hootsburg, our massive town of about 5,000 people in total. I'm now the Danger Ranger. I'm sorry I'm not wearing the shirt today. I didn't want to kind of give myself too big of a head on my first guarding experience with Wild Earth. Well, what a fun afternoon it has been. And Robin, once again, thank you for throwing it out there. Guys, and I do not want you to believe that I'm a dangerous man whatsoever, unless I have to be. So So now what I'm hoping for, we're going to spend a couple more minutes here, and I'm not sure if we're going to get the result that we are looking for, but if these guys wake up, the first thing they'll probably do is obviously have a bit of a look around, see if there's nothing fancying them, what's on the menu, and then if not, probably just go down for a sip of water down here by the dam. It doesn't look like they're too interested on getting moving. Now, some of you guys might be asking yourselves, why is this male and this female kind of hanging out alone here on the dam wall in their honeymoon suite, overlooking basically everything? They're on a nice little enliftment here. And I cannot actually truthfully answer you that, because what you'd generally be thinking is maybe there's a bit of a bush romance going on here. But generally, we've been maybe now 8 to 10 minutes. Normally, if they are mating, they'll mate on average about probably every 15 to 20 minutes. That male will be quite active if that's happening, and he's not looking too active to me right now, and I'm sure you guys can agree. So maybe they're just kind of breaking away from the rest of the pride. I'm not even sure if it is part of the same pride, but I'm assuming so, seeing as it's within very close proximity from each other, and other males won't normally, unless they actually come in to take over the pride, be relaxing this close to other lions' territories. You can see if we just trying to have a look at her teats there. It doesn't look like she's lactating, no. So she's definitely not one of the mothers, obviously, of one of those youngsters we saw earlier. And I'm not just saying that because she's lying here alone. Someone was trying to tell me something here. Sorry about that. Like I was saying, In the instance of a female having cubs, it's not always that they're going to be with those cubs. So I just want to clear that up. You can often have a lioness like this, even if she is the mother that is lying around. You can often have her away. And this is the spectacular thing about lions and them being so social. She will actually leave her sister or cousin or whoever's in the pride of age and experience with her youngsters if she needs to go out hunting or maybe just lazing around like she's doing now. But I'm pretty confident she's not one of the mothers because it doesn't look like she's lactating. I hear everybody out there is guessing or maybe advising, because maybe you know more than me about these lions. So keep it going and maybe we can work out what is going on here. So we just had a comment from Safari Jenny saying that this is the youngest female from this pride, Nkuhuma pride. So she's maybe just kind of taking it easy with Big Papa over here, or maybe there is a bit of bush romance that's starting to brew up there. Obviously, if she is an estrus, that's going to attract Big Daddy over there, and he's going to basically be following her around most of the way if he's wanting to mate and get involved over there. So very possible. So thank you for that comment. If she is one of the younger ones, we'll have a look back there. Now again, you can normally easily identify it with the spots on the hind legs and even just on the forelegs. You can often see that and kind of work out what their age is. They normally start losing, let's have a look, they normally start losing those spots after about 2.5 years, and you can see in fact there is still a slight bit of spots. If you look there at her front legs, just kind of in front of the face, there's a couple of spots that's still shown there. So thank you for that comment, Safari Jane. She does look like a youngster. Very good observation there. Alrighty guys, I think what we're going to do is we're going to leave these two in peace. Maybe leave them to their bush romance that's going on there. I'm sure they would like a bit of privacy in case things are happening, if the sparks are flying. So what we're going to do is we're going to bumble back towards the other lions there, and then we'll quickly see if they may be feeding on that buffalo, having some dinner just before we have to get back and have some dinner. Righty, let's get out of here. Thank you, you two. That was beautiful. Very nice surprise. Gene, I've got a question from you. Have I ever seen an animal in the bush giving birth? I have been fortunate enough to actually see that, and it actually leads to another dramatic event that I saw. I've seen impalas give birth a couple of times, actually, in my career and lifetime, just growing up in the bush. And of course, some of your predators, especially your smaller ones like your black-backed jackals, and even your younger hyenas and things like that, will take complete advantage of situations such as these. Obviously, straight after birth, the animal is not at its greatest strength, although it is amazing with things like impalas. It's about 30 seconds and that young impala can be up and running to get away from danger. But things like your jackals take advantage, and that's exactly what I saw. And this was actually, where was it? It was either Serengeti or Masai Mara where we saw this, where they actually went and took a baby impala as she was giving birth. I'll tell you what, there is a whole load more births that I wish I can see. Something like giraffe just kind of like dropping 2 meters, welcome to earth, and then kind of stumbling up, getting to their feet. Elephant birth is something I'll give my front teeth to see. I actually have a good friend, Liam, he's seen it before. Very, very jealous for that fact. But yeah, just once again, the fact remains, the more time you spend out here, the bigger the probability of seeing something like that. Laura, you are asking me what's my favorite bush flower, and that's a very easy answer for me. It's an impala lily. It is very, very beautiful. It's kind of got, starts off with a bit of pink and then normally a bit of white around the edges. Very, very, very beautiful flower. Impala lily, if you're not sure what it looks like, just hop on Google. I'm sure there's lots of pictures that will pop up there for you. There's just impalas everywhere around these plains here. Quite a typical thing for impalas to do as we go along. Let me quickly just take a stop here. I know time is passing by, but just look at those numbers. They are absolutely everywhere. And like I say, quite a typical thing for this time of the day, because what do they want to do? They are now going from having a lovely stroll around during the day into the evening, becoming potential prey for something like those lions that is, what, not even 200 meters, 200 yards back. So they want to kind of head to these open areas in great numbers. This is not one herd that Brian is moving through now. This is going to be a couple of herds together, but they come together, safety in numbers, extra eyes, extra ears on these open plains, so they can see danger basically coming from a long way out. So that also brings me to the point of how they sleep. They don't all go and sleep at the same time. They'll kind of do it in shifts, almost like if I go sleep out in the bush with some of my friends, without any defense mechanism, without any barriers, we just go and plunk down in the middle of a riverbed. We at least make sure one of us awake the whole time to kind of spot danger. So the same concept, just look at this beautiful landscape that we're going through. There's just nothing like a nice African sunset, is there? If you actually, there we go. Guys, so I'm going to leave you with this beautiful scene of this sun setting, and I'm going to get you guys back in touch there with James, and I believe he is still with the leopard. So let's have a look what's going on there.
That's what's going on here, everybody. Miss Shadow, seems to have somehow conjured a light from the heavens. You see that, everyone? It's amazing. It is, of course, a spotlight on her from the vehicle next to us. And I don't think we're going to watch her once the light's faded. I think we'll head on and see what else we can find in the darkness as it falls. She's given us a wonderful time, so I think we'll just probably move out of here in the next 5 minutes or so. I just want to see if she perhaps goes up to fetch her little Impala lamb. So just to reconfirm, I don't know if I told you this, but I think the kill that she had is an Impala lamb. I don't think it's a Steenbok. And I think that because of the color of the pelage or the fur. And I wonder if she didn't kill the adult and then have that stolen in much the same way that Karula did that a few days back. She's got very lengthy whiskers, you know. And interestingly, how's this? The only other leopard I've seen with whiskers that lengthy are her sons. Sindile has got wonderfully long whiskers like that. Now, just quickly, while I remember, she's a 3-4 female in the same way that her mother is 3-4 female. She's got three spots there over the whiskers. Oh, and then four on the other side. And Tina, that dovetails nicely with your question about what would happen if the two of them met. They do meet from time to time. Last time they met, I think Shadow blew spit bubbles at her mother, which is disgusting, and nobody should ever do that to their mother. But they would have a kind of small territorial spat. It wouldn't be serious. There would be no physical contact. But they'd have a bit of a standoff. Sometimes they'd share a kill. But I think at this stage, you know, it's been so long since Shadow left home, 9 years or so. No, not 9 years, 7 years or so. That I think it's highly unlikely that they would share a kill at this stage. But it does happen from time to time. And I mean, the best story I've ever heard of a leopardess meeting her daughter was when the 3-4 female of Londolozi met up with a... I'll tell you the story later. We've got some unusual canids with Christopher.
Righty, guys. Well, whilst we were on our way back to this crime scene over here with the lions, we've just come across a black-backed jackal, but he's kind of getting his bum in gear and getting a move on, because obviously those lions are probably coming back to the carcass. You can see him just there down the road. I'm going to try and stop now and we can get a bit of a clear view. But he's really getting a move on there. Very, very beautiful animal, actually. Very similar to a fox, as most of you guys will know. There we go. Come on, buddy. Relax. Hey, relax. You're far away now. Let's quickly try. I want to get you guys a little bit of a better view there. Just been told it's not something you guys see too much out here. And that's obviously because of the high predation and hyenas and everything that's around. Let's just see if we can quickly get a second look over here. There he is, right in front. There we go. Assuming he's going to calm down a little bit now that he's a bit of a distance away. There we go. Well, there we go, folks, a black-backed jackal. Unfortunately, a little bit of mange. If you look at the tail there, a bit of hair loss. But what an awesome sighting. You can see it's a male. If you look just below the tail there, it's very obvious. And you can see how he's itching. Shame. I feel very sorry for these animals. You know, mange is basically a mite that goes and gets either into follicles of the hair or under the skin. It must be very, very annoying. So these guys, your black-back jackals, they're obviously mainly scavengers, but don't get me wrong, I just told you a story about how they took a young impala. And also, very often, one of the photographers of the year photos that got taken and went into the book for Africa Geographic was one of these guys, a black-back jackal, taking a Franklin. What are you smelling there, buddy? So yeah, they're mainly scavengers. Oh, you know what he's looking for there? I can almost guarantee you he's looking for beetles. So it's some old elephant dung probably over there, old elephant poo, and he's digging around. Obviously, dung beetles are going to utilize that, and he knows this. Very clever little guy. He's digging around there trying to find maybe a beetle or two. Let me try this pile of poo. Trying to see if we can pick up some movement. And you can very clearly see where they get that name from. Just look at that beautiful black back. Now, if they don't have mange, I don't want to say more beautiful, because this is an absolutely stunning little creature, but it becomes almost more clear, that back and the, kind of the contrast from that kind of rustic type of color to that black back with the white highlights. Beautiful, beautiful creature. Very similar to a fox, I'm sure all of you will agree. Are you going to be able to get your beetle, buddy? Because obviously those lions aren't very sharing. You got chased away straight away. We just missed that, I'm sure. See, he's almost using a bit of a hunting technique there, looking for a bit of movement, have a scratch. If I was you, I'd just start scratching everywhere. There must be a beetle somewhere hidden around there. There we go. Come on. Oh, ladies and gentlemen, I thought I was going to show you guys a kill now on day number one, but unfortunately not. Ooh, look there in the... Look in the background now. That is an awesome, awesome bird there as well, guys. That is a black-bellied korhan. Look at that beautiful black belly over there. Quite a big bird. Look at him compared to the size of that jackal. Oh, sorry, the name has actually changed. I want to correct myself. I'm going to double check myself in the book as well. But I think it's gone from a blackberry coron to a blackberry bustard. I just want to double check here for you guys. Obviously, don't want to give you the wrong information. Blackberry bustard. There we go. Shame, this guy is very, very itchy. Sometimes feel sorry for these animals and you just want to kind of hop off the vehicle and give them a bit of a scratch. Obviously, we can't do that. We don't want to interfere with nature and what's going on out here. The best is just to let wildlife kind of take a stroll and, you know, get along with it. Oh, this guy is giving us an amazing show now. See how those fork-tailed drongos over there are just, I'm not sure if you guys can hear it as well as me. They're kind of doing a mobbing display onto that that jackal, just trying to scare it, saying, get out of here. Don't want you wandering around. If we just go to the top left of that knob thorn over there, you'll see the fork-tailed drongo still screaming and shouting. Quite an easy bird to identify. You can see that very clear fork in the tail. Absolutely successful birds in this area. They're actually excellent at mimicking other calls of birds, which obviously helps them a huge amount in terms of trying to get things or trying to make alarm calls, even making sounds like mongoose and things like that. Quite fascinating. Also, a good technique that they often use is they'll actually follow other animals, big animals especially, like your giraffes and your buffalo and elephants. And first of all, these animals do have flies and things following them, so they'll grab that. But not just that, they're also the insects that get scared, as let's say the elephant is busy feeding on a bush, they'll go down and grab that. So very, very intelligent little guy. Alrighty guys, let us get out of here. That was an awesome sighting. I'm sure you guys would all agree with me on that beautiful black-back jackal. From here, we're going to go back to those lines. I think I'm getting a question through from Monique in London. Monique in London, alrighty. Your question is, how big is a jackal? If we're working with centimeters here, I'll first give you a bit of a shoulder height there. I think it's about a 28 centimeter shoulder height, 20 to 30, so not a massively, we're talking about a ruler size, maybe a little bit bigger, maybe 35 centimeters to be precise. Compared to, let's say, a domestic dog, I'll say a Staffy Terrier, if you guys do get those dogs there. I hope I'm not confusing anyone right now. Sorry, let me just quickly get this vehicle to pass. Sure, Malume, are you? Good, good. Nangala's still there? Lalapanzi? They're Famba?
I chase him.
You chase them?
Yeah.
Ah, but?
But not always.
They're Kujaing there or not?
No,
Lala's team.
Ah, lazy boy, lazy girl.
Okay. Cheers, my brother. Have a good one. Enjoy. Cheers, guys. Can you get past there?
Yeah.
Good.
Hey, Makulu car.
Makulu Mova. He's just mentioning how much bigger his vehicle is than mine, so making him a bit jealous there. This little guy that I'm driving, Mr. Rusty, goes just about anywhere. Let's go have a quick look at these lines. Monique from London, I hope I answered your question. I am actually not that good with dogs, so for me to compare it to a dog, I don't know if you know what a Staffy Terrier is. It's quite a stocky dog. Obviously the Jackal isn't that stocky, but the height, I'd say, is about similar.